Thanks a lot, Tanya, for taking out time and conducting this Ask Me Anything session for Pragmatic Leaders.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we are really glad to see you here. So before we start today's session, I would like to give you all a little brief about Pragmatic Leaders. Pragmatic Leaders, you all are part of a global family of aspirational professionals who proactively help each other and are invested in each other's career growth. Pragmatic Leaders functions like a full-stack global career accelerator that rests on three core pillars. Pillar one is educate. We help you upskill via proven courses and professional industry coaches. Pillar two is engage. We run a global community of product managers on Slack with access to online and offline meetups, mock interview preparation sessions, and a lot more. Pillar three is employ. We operate a job platform and dedicated interview preparation courses to help you crack your dream job. So with that note, let's begin the session now. Tanya has already joined us. I hope everyone is super excited for this session. Tanya, we would like to hear a short intro about your journey so far.
Sure. Hi, everyone, and thank you so much, Pragmatic Leaders and Piyush, for organizing this and letting me speak up and host this session. I am very, very glad to be a part of this. A brief about me. I have been a product manager for almost 5 years now. I did my engineering. I did my engineering in bioinformatics. I'm not sure if a lot of people know, but it's more like IT and biotechnology together. So it was after my engineering, I did a 2-year stint with Accenture, and it was more like a digital marketing profile, post which I went on to do my MBA from XIMB. After my MBA, I joined ICICI Bank as a product manager, and I was there for almost 2 years. That is exactly where my product journey began, and I got an introduction to the banking sector and the role of product manager per se. I was lucky enough to have worked on multiple projects and a lot of front-end as well as back-end applications, platforms, website designing, a number of projects which helped me to not only attain certain kind of knowledge into product management from my seniors, my mentors and my colleagues, but to also understand the industry per se, which is banking, and how a product manager's role in banking is so much different from what my friends in other industries were actually doing. So that was a great experience at ICICI Bank. After ICICI, I thought I'll try something different, and I joined Future Retail as a technical product manager, which is again a kind of associated field with product management, but more on the technical side. We'll talk more about it in my session. At Future Group, I was part of the loyalty and customer solutions team, wherein I happened to gain a lot of knowledge into product platforms, and I was owning, so I was a product owner for an application called One Loyalty, on which multiple other loyalty programs resided, and I had the chance to design and ideate new products and product enhancements from scratch, and we built great products there during my tenure. After Future Group, I have recently joined RBL Bank, again back to banking. I'm part of the credit cards team here, and it's good to be back in banking, but again, it is again a new bank, a different kind of sector, so a hell lot of to learn again. So this is about me, and I hope you guys are interactive. I would love to hear from you guys also in the chat, or you can just unmute and speak up if you have any questions in between.
So first we have a question, how to create balanced profile on working on backend systems and at the same time working on customer facing systems?
Interesting question. It totally depends on what kind of industry and company you're currently working with. So if I can draw parallels from my example, when I was with ICICI Bank, I was in fact handling projects which were related to users' journey on the website that we had. So what I did was, because in fact when I started my career, I also wanted to have a balanced profile, and I thought working on both kinds of being a customer centric product manager and an you know, an application or a platform product manager is something that gives your profile a little boost. So I had similar concerns. So what I really did was that, you know, I started picking up projects. So even though I was working on the user journeys and, you know, going to Google Analytics and seeing that where my drops are and, you know, which pages I should enhance the look and feel of, or whether I should reduce the number of clicks for a customer to log in, stuff like that. At the same time, I realized that, you know, there were a lot of drop-offs on the payment page and a lot of drop-offs wherein the customers were being shown the the number of days in which the transaction actually happens. So to give you a little background, I was working with an inward remittance system, which is essentially nothing but a cross-border payment system for NRIs. So for example, I was working on a use case wherein my customers in Australia are trying to send in money back to India to their NRE accounts or to their relatives' accounts. So it's a simple bank-to-bank transfer. But because it's an overseas transfer, there are a lot of compliance and, you know, operational issues. So it was taking around 5 days of TAT, a turnaround time of 5 days for the customer from Australia to send money across to India. Now, even though it was not really my issue, because I am more concerned about, you know, customers dropping on the payment page, I thought, why not pick up a project and reduce this number of days? So, I started speaking to the backend team. I started speaking to the people on the operations side, and I volunteered to work on projects wherein, you know, this process enhancement also took place. So one is that you can pick up projects internally and figure out how you can deep dive into how systems are working, how even if you're working on a front end or a, you know, customer facing sort of a product, you can start learning more about the back end of it, you know, how the APIs are connected, or is there a middleware in between, how the database is connected, can you utilize some sort of data to garner more insights from that data and use in your front end product. You know, these kind of stepping out of your comfort zone and picking up such kind of projects can be a good way to do this. And then another is, if you feel that you're totally stuck and you're pigeonholed into some sort of, you know, one piece itself, and your company or your role does not give you enough room to get into backend stuff, then I think switching at the right time is also a good option. So you probably may want to get into a B2B company or a bigger conglomerate which has bigger applications, and you can get into a more technical role. So yeah.
Next we have a question. How does the job of a product manager in banking industry differ from a product manager in other industries, say e-commerce?
Yeah. So, like I told you, when you are a product manager in a bank, first of all, you know, banking products are so much more different than other products, because number one, they take ages to get rolled out. You know, the process of product development to shipping them out is so long in a bank, because of, you know, you have a compliance team and you have legal teams and you have risk teams which need to go through your process, which needs to be on board, you know, before you're actually launching anything. Because you know, in a banking setup, it's the customer's data that you're working with, and a huge bank or a bank with a prestige, a lot of customers are, you know, sort of they need to be transparent and they need to be bankable. You know, the term bankable itself came from a bank, which means that customers really rely on the security and the systems of a bank. So when you're developing products for a banking system, you need to make sure that you're following the guidelines of RBI, you're into the perfect framework is being followed. So one is that the time to ship out the products is really, really long because of all these approvals and all these different stakeholders that need to be consulted before actually, you know, pushing out a product. And which really does not happen in a e-commerce or any other field. So definitely when it comes to the role of a product manager, it becomes really difficult, because then you need to keep selling and reselling your enhancement or your product to different stakeholders. You need to make sure that everybody is on board, the senior management, the risk people, the compliance is on boarded with your... So, you know, in fact, to tell you an example, I was working on a very, very small enhancement on the customer website that we had at ICICI. In fact, it was such a small change, just, you know, we had to change the terms and conditions on one of the web pages. It took me almost a month and a half just to get compliance team's approval. So, which I think would be a half a day's job in if I was in a Zomato or a Ola sort of setup. So, this is like a classic example of, you know, how a role of a TPM is completely different in these two scenarios. So, yeah.
So, next question is on the same line. So, what are the key product management challenges that you face in a banking sector?
I think, again, I have already spoken a lot about, you know, these kind of challenges. So it starts from, you know, making sure that you need to internally manage a lot of stakeholders and need to get all the approvals done in time. You need to be very, very, you know, disciplined, because a banking is a very, very, you know, rigid sort of a job. It's more like you have fixed working hours and you cannot take your work home because of the data security issues. So you need to finish everything while you're in the office. You cannot take work on the weekends. So it becomes a great challenge to, you know, sort of push everything to the edge and work within those boundaries. And a lot of times you would want a certain enhancement, but then the legal would just, you know, throw your idea out of the window and they say this is not even possible because, you know, the RBI says this, you know, something else. So yeah, the challenge would be to not always be able to do what you actually want to. So I think this is one of the biggest challenge. I'm getting something from Kushal. Can you please elaborate on the difference between roles and responsibilities of a technical PM versus functional PM? Sure. When it comes to a TPM is more like, so there's a functional product manager and then there's a development team, a technical team. A TPM would be somewhere a bridge between that functional team, the business team, and the development, the actual developers and the coders. So wherein a functional manager would be more concerned about, you know, how he would get more, let's say, traction on the website, or how the revenue or the number of transactions should be more at the end of the day after this product release. A TPM would be more bothered about, you know, things like which infrastructure to use. Do I need one server or two server? Will an AWS work? Should it be a hybrid sort of a thing? What should be the response rate? Will my application, what kind of tech stack should be used? So probably a TPM in consultation with the engineering manager and the dev team would come up with something like, you know, which development languages to be used, which database to be used, whether Mongo would be better or an DBMS, SQL would be better. So stuff like this. It's more technical. It's more detailed. And, while a functional PM would only be focused on the revenue generation or the footfall or the the end metrics from the product, a TPM would be more focused on how that particular metrics would be achieved. So functional would be what and a TPM would be how. That's the difference.
So I'll take up the next question. What are the biggest challenges in product development in banking sector?
I think it's on the same lines, like I said. Making sure that your product is shipped on time, then getting all the stakeholders on board. Also, I think a major challenge is to create viable products for the industry, because when you're working with bank, a number of things keep on changing. For example, in recent times, due to this COVID scenario, RBI suddenly came up with a moratorium, right? So all of us PMs in the banking sector were like, you know, how we should enhance our existing digital channels or existing products to accommodate such a emergent sort of a need. So you have to be always on your toes and thinking that how you have to incorporate a sudden macroeconomic level change into your existing systems and roll it out in a certain time, because, you know, RBI would always come with a deadline that post 31st or post 30th, this has to be there. So these are, again, like I told you, you know, and apart from that, you need to make sure that you are in working within the guidelines of the RBI. There's a particular framework that needs to be followed. And I think in banking, more or less, you're always firefighting rather than more of ideation, because, you know, new things keep coming up, new guidelines keep cropping up, and you need to always be up to the mark with the other competition banks. So, yeah, these are the challenges.
Next question is from Abhishek. What do banks like ICICI and RBI look for while hiring a product manager in India?
Okay. From my experience, I have never been asked a banking question in any of the banks' interviews. Even though it's a myth that, you know, banks are old school and they would want you to have some sort of banking knowledge beforehand. But trust me, that's not the case anymore nowadays. They would see, you know, just your analytical thinking, or they would throw in a couple of use cases. What you can do to prepare more for a banking interview is you can incorporate more banking examples when you're talking about your product journey. So if it's a typical question of, you know, how do you face challenge as a PM, then probably you can pick up examples like, you know, if I'm working in a bank and then there's a product that needs, that is probably solving a payment solution. So, you know, rather than you being asked a question about banking, it's more about how you can incorporate banking in your answers in an interview process. That's what I feel. But according to me, they don't really look for anything particular. It's just like any other interview, any other technical or product management interview.
So next question we have from Atul. What is the paper experience level for product managers, bankings?
Okay, so it completely depends. See, there's no fixed answer to this, and I don't want you guys to, like, you know, say that it completely depends on whether it's a startup or it's a mid-level company, or you're talking about bigger companies like ICICI Bank or, you know, Future or HUL for that matter. What I have typically seen is when you're an APM, when you're an associate product manager, the salary structure post, if you are from a tier 1 to tier 2 MBA college, it generally lies between 12 to 14 lakhs per annum. Again, you know, just a ballpark number, because based on my experience. And as you grow the ladder, if you become a product manager and you have around 3 to 4 years of experience, it could go anywhere between 15 to 20 lakhs. And more than that, depending on whether it's a startup, I have even seen product managers getting up to 30, 35 lakhs per annum. So it completely depends on your pedigree, which college you did your MBA from, are you an IIT? And because again, you know, being in Indian corporates, IIT, IIM is always a better notch than rest of the institute. So yeah, totally depends on all that. But yeah, anywhere between 12 to 30 is, it's a wide range, I know, but yeah, anywhere between that.
Great. Next, we have question from Nikita. How do you overcome big bank legacy systems and old world thinking to innovate and move your product forward?
Yeah. That's a very good question, Nikita. In fact, you're absolutely right that, you know, banking is pretty old school in terms of when it comes to their digital systems, especially the backend systems, the applications which actually handle transactions. Major reason of which is that, you know, the industry as a whole has not really transformed digitally as much as we would like. Especially in India, because still a lot of government banks are the major stakeholders in the industry. For me, how do I try to innovate is that, you know, we create a huge tech product backlog. In fact, you know, when I was working with Future, even if it's not a bank, Future Group also had a lot of, you know, what do I say, old legacy systems, like you say. So what we did there was we used to pick up one aspect of the system or one process and then try to automate it and then put it in our backlog. So whenever we had time between the business scenarios, whenever we had, you know, 2 to 3 weeks sprint time between any two major project releases, we would try to finish up our tech backlog and we would try to enhance what we already have in the system. And in fact, that really worked for us. Within a short span of, I think, 8 to 9 months, we transformed almost 5 to 6 manual processes, which were handled by, you know, 5 to 6 people on Excel sheets. We transformed it completely to a digitally automated systems on SAP. So yeah, it really helps if you start, you know, picking piece by piece and then trying to digitize it. Yeah.
Great. Next, we have question from Atul again, what are the key thoughts on how a company can be more customer-centric?
Yeah, so customer-centricity, see, I have always felt that for an organization to be customer-centric, it always has to be a top-down approach. You know, you being customer-centric and one of your colleagues being customer-centric and thinking like a customer, putting yourself in customer's shoes and building a product would not really achieve the result if your boss does not think so, right? So, in fact, organizations should inculcate customer into their DNA itself. And I have seen a lot of organizations who have, this sort of aspirations, and they even put it up on a wall. Like, you know, at RBL, we have something like customer centricity as one of our goals, one of our KPIs to be achieved at the end of the year. And we have it written all across, you know, on our meeting rooms and on our cafeterias and our buildings, so that we keep reiterating the fact that whatever we are doing, whatever we are building or even, you know, ideating has to be a solution to a customer problem. And that is where companies and products and teams and you would follow that journey, would create and innovate products which are more customer-centric and, you know, built for customers and not for companies.
Next question we have on product strategy framework. So how product strategy framework for banking products is different from B2B products?
So see, product strategy framework is nothing but, you know, how you envisage the roadmap of a product, right? So like I told you, you know, banking is a very, very complex industry, and there are so many macro economic factors that come into the play when you're talking about products in a banking sector. While when you're talking about B2B products, they might have multiple stakeholders. In a B2B scenario, your clients are generally businesses, and in banks they could be businesses or they could be end customers, both, you know, because banks also deal with large corporates or SMEs or at the end retail customers. So when you're talking about a product framework, you would always start with, you know, what needs to be built and whether it needs to be built from ground up. So in I think most of the times when you're talking about banking, you have to build applications, you have to build products which are from ground up, because, you know, there's a new requirement or the banking scenario has changed, or there are some other guidelines that need to be followed, or probably you just need to have a more omni-channel experience for your customers, and you're probably creating a new chatbot, and you're getting, you know, more, you're creating something which is more digital in nature and making sure that your customer is, you know, your customer's journey is smoother. So in that way, the framework definitely changes when it comes to banking rather than a B2B setup, because in B2B, you're essentially working for clients, and you know what your clients' requirements are. So you probably can just work on a single enhancement, and what you could in fact even customize it to your clients' needs. But in banking, you're catering a huge segment. So you have to build products, you have to pick up projects which solve bigger problems, which solve with smaller changes, more impact is made. So yeah, that way it's very different.
So next question, how do you draw your boundaries as a product manager? It's a long question. How do you encourage everyone you work with to come up with new ideas and strategies, but at the same time, you do not want to push your methods and thoughts on them? How do you manage these conflicts of thoughts and opinions?
Okay, very nice question. And a lot of times that really does happen, that, you know, you have a set of requirements and you go back to your team, to your developers, and you say that this is what you really want. But then there are stakeholders, there are probably your senior management or probably the development team, they say that this kind of thing is not possible, or probably they are choked on the bandwidth. So there, what I generally do is that, you know, empathy really helps. Sometimes just blindly pushing your agenda onto others would just create more friction. So rather than just, asking them to follow what you have already decided and, you know, created a BRD and say that you follow the steps and you're not ready to listen to the other team or their feedback, it would just hamper your relationship. So rather than that, what I generally do is I sit and brainstorm with my seniors also, and I would sit and brainstorm with the development team also, with my other stakeholders, be it the sales team, be it the marketing team or the operations team. So everybody needs to be felt safe enough or you know, in a safe space to in fact voice their opinion. And you never know, you can get some brilliant ideas out of them. And then probably, you know, you can go back and reiterate and say that I have picked up your idea, I have rejected yours, and this is the new thing that I've come up with. Take a sign off from everybody, make sure that everybody is on board, and then go ahead with the particular piece. Rather than just going blindly and saying that, you know, this is what we have decided and need to follow it, that's not a good approach at all. So I generally always, try to create that sort of environment where we all are brainstorming, we all are coming up with the idea. And, you know, in this way, everybody feels responsible also. So in the end, when the actual output is generated, that sense of gratification is there that, you know, you have equally contributed to that sort of outcome. So it really helps.
So we'll take one last question from the list. How do you keep yourself up to date on the latest in technology? What do you recommend as a good source of knowledge for a product manager?
Yeah, so frankly, I don't get a lot of time apart because, my schedule is super, super hectic. So generally, whatever time I get over the weekends and, when I'm traveling, I would try to read articles on Medium, or I would open TechCrunch. It's got some amazing articles there, and you can always keep up to date with what's happening globally. So it's not enough to just read, you know, what your friends are writing on LinkedIn or some local articles. It really helps if you're on Slack, on TechCrunch, because there is a huge product management global community, and they talk about so many different things that we haven't even heard of. It really gives you a great perspective. And apart from that, you know, webinars from like Pragmatic Leaders, and there are so many influencers on LinkedIn which have great content. And I do a lot of LinkedIn learning classes as well. And then there is Udemy and Upgrade, and you can always enroll yourself into sessions, attend as many webinars, as many seminars as you can. Go out and meet new product managers, you know, from meet your colleagues, talk to them, network. That's like the goal, you know, you should network like anything. And that really helps. And that's what I do to, you know, keep abreast with what's happening around.
Okay.
The quick failures that one can commit in POPM role, across different domains, what are the failures or where you have stumbled on? Okay. So I think this question is more on, you know, whether what are the failures which I have stumbled on, and have I ever thought of giving up on this role at all? Okay, nice question, Adi. Yes, to be frank, there are times when you are burnt out and you have worked 15 hours and you've worked on something and it didn't materialize, or you worked on a product for like 3 to 4 months, you gave your blood and sweat to the project, and then it did not give you the results that you were really hoping for. It could be in terms of revenue, or it could be in terms of that the customer just did not like it, and you know, you're not getting that sort of traction that you really expected initially when you were, you know, working on the product. Has happened a couple of times, and it really puts your morale down. But at the end of the day, I feel that it's just a bump in the road, and it's a learning. And only if you fail, you will know what not to do next time, right? So it's very important to fail as well. I think there should not be any reason to thinking of giving up on this role, because I think as a product manager, I always say you must have also read somewhere that, you know, you are the CEO of a product when you are a product manager. I say you are the CEO, you are the janitor, you are the secretary, you are the operations, you are everything of a product. So this particular role really pushes you to your limits, and you should never think of giving up. And, you know, always keep learning from your failures. Make sure that you don't repeat your mistakes. And always keep doing better.
Next, we have a question from Soliappan. The face of banking is taking a change while technology like blockchain and peer-to-peer banking ways. Do you keep those or sell it to stakeholders? Or does the bank feel it's necessary to invest in such techs in the products? Being first in the market matters here.
Okay. Yes, you're right that banking is totally changing with the advent of blockchain and peer-to-peer banking, and even, you know, stuff like what Samsung is doing with Tap and Pay. And there's so many different technologies AI has entered. So definitely it is very imperative for banks to be the first in the industry. And and banks are definitely investing in techs like this. In fact, most of the bigger banks now, be it ICICI, Axis, as far as, you know, HDFC also, they all have something called labs. So in fact, I have been in touch with product managers from such labs, which are continuously innovating on newer technologies and how to incorporate these newer technologies into existing products and making life of the consumer simpler. So yes, it's definitely there, and huge investment is being made in this regard. Yes.
Next, we have a question from Premanku. Do the banks use a lot of data science products, and is there a need to know data science to be product manager for such products? What level of knowledge is expected?
See, most banks have a separate data analytics team where data scientists are already working. So I have not really seen product managers who would require such knowledge per se, like, you know, core data science knowledge, but probably a bit of knowledge about R or a course in Python or a course in Tableau would help if you want to work in a data science team in a bank. But if you're just working as a PM, you really do not need to know in-depth knowledge. Just general data analytics, like analytics per se, should be your strength. So you should be able to derive insights from data. That is what is required. But to answer your question, that do the banks use a lot of data science products, then yes, a lot. In fact, like I told you, they have invested a lot in data science projects, data science teams. There are people who are working day and night to garner insights from the spending, how a customer is really spending, making sure that the right target segment is derived and then approached. So for example, if I have the credit history data of all my customers, I would start deriving insights into, you know, what each customer's spending pattern is, and probably I would try to cross-sell products, or I will try to cross-sell insurance or mutual funds or investment products where the customer's interests lie. So, you know, probably this is where the entire data science and in these sort of applications come into picture. So to answer your question, yes, the banks do invest a lot in these products. And as a PM, if you are working in that team, then of course you would require that particular knowledge. But if you're just working as a PM in any other category, then these tools and this requirement is not really mandatory. It's just good to have.
Next, we have a question from Subhashish. What are the challenges you see in banking, tech or business transformation? Example, data migration, legacy to strategic technologies, etc. And what would you suggest on approaching such transformation initiatives?
What are the challenges you see in banking? Okay. Yeah, so in fact, it's a huge challenge because I'll give you an example. When I was working with ICICI Bank, we had customer data of 90 lakh customers. which was not validated properly. So when we were building this new product, we wanted to migrate the data, the older data, the historical data, onto a newer database. But since, because there was so much, the data was not curated and the validations were not in place at that time, so it was a lot of junk data and a huge lot of cleaning needed to be done before we could actually migrate it. And in fact, we could not even migrate the entire thing. So it's a huge, huge challenge, because banking data is a lot. You get debit cards data and you get transactional data, and there are like lakhs and lakhs of transactions which are happening in real time daily. So to actually have systems who can successfully, you know, curate such data is the biggest challenge right now in this industry. And what would you suggest on approaching such transformation initiatives? I'm not sure whether you're asking from an organizational point of view or you're asking as a PM, but like I told you, I have worked on a project like that, and when it was given to me, I can tell you my experience. I took 6 months to manually curate the data on Excel. So there was nothing else that we could do. So that's the way about it. Sometimes you need to do the laundry work to actually get something done. So there are tools in the market nowadays, but I have not seen banks really relying on third-party tools. One, because of data privacy issues, and two, because they are not open to exposing their APIs and exposing their internal systems to third-party tools. So that is also a very, very big challenge that I have seen happening.
Next, we have a question from Sumit. How do you collect end-user feedback and prioritize them? Any tips?
It totally depends on the product that you're working with. I remember calling 100 people in a day for customer feedback. So it totally depends on, you know, how you would want your feedback to be. So for example, if you have built, if you've launched a new app, let's say in the market, you can simply put a survey form at the end, or you can go back to your Android or iOS ratings and say what is the NPS, the net promoter score that you're getting. If you build a website, you could put a small short survey at the end and say, you know, how your customers liked it, what did they not like. If you're working on a B2B application, or if you're working on a platform per se, which is more like a software as a service, then you should call up your clients and ask whether this particular enhancement or product meets their needs, meets the needs of their clients, their customers, whether it's a B2B to C. So you should always jot down whatever you feedback you get, and then prioritize based on, you know, your requirements. So for example, who are your biggest customers? So if it totally depends on, you know, the kind of product you're working with. So suppose you also had some sort of tech backlog, or you had some sort of enhancements that you had already planned, and your customers are also reiterating the same thing, then definitely it's a first pick. That is what you should do first. Secondly, if it's something that, you know, some of your customers have said and others have not said, probably you would want to put it at the bottom. You would not want to pick it up right away. So that is how you prioritize, you know. And a third factor could be the budgets you have. Sometimes you're working in a startup, or you're working on your own product, and you don't have that sort of financial means or that sort of number of hands or number of people who could spend time and the bandwidth on that particular enhancement. So always prioritize based on your resources. So yeah, this is how you should, like, you know, close the entire loop.
Next, we have a question from
next.
Amit.
Yeah. So can a product not be successful in today's time without support from AI, data science, RPA? Can a product not be successful? So, okay, why there are two negatives in the sentence? Anyways, actually, I didn't quite get the question. So if Amit, you are there, probably you would want to ask it again. Okay. I don't think a product cannot be successful in today's times just because it's not got the RPA element to it or the AI element to it. Of course, they are the need of the hour. In fact, industries like hospitality have also started using AI, which we could never, envisage. So, and definitely data science is everywhere in most of the industries. But still, there are a lot of products which are, again, rudimentary, grassroots level products, which probably are still working just as fine without these things. Like you said, definitely the need of the hour, or to be abreast with what's happening globally, or to be competitive in the market, you definitely need support from IoT or AI or your blockchain or whatever new technologies are there in the market. Definitely, you would want to incorporate it to get better results from your customers. But then again, it's a very open-ended question, and it totally depends on what you're working on. So yeah. Next. So Leappan has asked, what do you do in the first 30 days of your new job? And what do you recommend for PMs taking up new jobs? Okay. frankly, I enjoyed in the first 30 days of my new job. But one very, very big aspect to enjoying is networking. Even though I was, I was a part of the... a huge management trainee program when I joined my first job, I got to network a lot with another 250 people who had joined across from B schools, across from some superb engineering institutes, and were joining at either my level or a level above. You get to learn so much from their experiences, and that is where you build in your network, right? Tomorrow you would want to switch, or you would want to probably open your own startup or get into a better profile, switch your careers. This is the network that's that's going to help you. And I think just making a lot of new connections is something that you should focus on in the first 30 days. That's it. I hope that suffices. Next, we have something from Suresh. In the conception stage, when we are either building a new product or trying a new feature, since we do not have much data to make concrete decisions, how do we manage conflicting opinions from stakeholders? Very good question, Suresh. In fact, a lot of times I have faced that challenge myself. I think the key element here to do is to just experiment. I know sometimes you do get a lot of conflicting opinions, and then you may want to reconsider what you have already decided. But I think gut feeling and intuition is something that a product manager should always go along with, and backed by data, of course. You should always do your homework, always do competition benchmarking, always derive insights from what existing products and existing scenarios, use cases you already have. And then probably at the end, go with your intuition. If you see that there is some meet in some of the opinion, then probably incorporate that in your journey. Otherwise, go ahead with what you feel is the best. So, because you don't have a lot to play around with, it's a new feature. It's an experiment, and it's okay to fail. It's okay to do A/B testing and figure out that, this worked, this did not work. You can always enhance it, go back, reiterate, come back and launch a better product. So yeah, you can always do that. Okay. So, I have just got through as e-commerce product manager in retail sector. Please let me know the growth and opportunities going forward. Okay, Vishal, congratulations, first of all. E-commerce is a very, very growing industry. Don't get bogged down by the recent COVID scenario. It's going to bounce back. It's the only sector which has shown tremendous amount of growth in the recent months, in the recent years. And this is where most of the innovation is happening today, E-commerce is where the latest technologies are. E-commerce is what consumers are focused on. Most of the biggest investors are focused on this category in this industry. So this is the place to be, first of all. And in a retail sector, there are tremendous amount of opportunities. Though it's a bit, sidelined at the moment because of the, current situation, the deliveries are not happening, and the retail sector is a bit on a slump because people are not really going out and purchasing. But at the end of the day, it's gonna bounce back probably in 6 months or a year. And this sector is always going to be, you know, the way it is. It is always going to be on a growth pattern. So tremendous amount of opportunities in India, within India. There are new age startups that are coming up. And also, I would like to highlight one more thing here. When you see e-commerce, even if you have joined in a retail sector right now, probably let's say you have joined Amazon or you have joined Walmart, but even Policy Bazaar is also an e-commerce, right? Any company who's giving up their services on an e-commerce platform, on a website, is in the same sector. So probably you don't want to limit your growth and opportunities within the retail itself. You can always shift out, get into Zomato's of the world or Ola or Uber or, you know, any company that is working on similar lines. So there are huge opportunities. And one tip I would give you here is to stick around. Do not leave e-commerce, do not leave retail within like a year or two. Try to stick it around and learn as much as you can, because there are a lot of global opportunities as well in this sector. There are a lot of global companies that have back offices in India, in Pune, in Gurgaon. And I know I have friends who have shifted from future retail into these companies, are doing tremendously well and earning a lot and, you know, doing a great amount of growth. So yeah, all the best for your future. One last question and then I think we'll wrap up. Okay. Have you ever got crushed between your reporting manager and your product manager? Have you negotiated this decision? So Adi, I have always been a product manager. And so there was not anyways between. Probably, I'm not sure from whose viewpoint you're asking. If you're talking about from an engineer's perspective, that if you're crushed between your manager and your product manager, then I would always say that, you know, take inputs from both, give your own feedback and try to figure out a solution with everybody on board, and then, you know, sort of work on something. Do not ever try to, like, you know, go with just one person, because it's imperative that everybody's on the same page when you're working on a project, because at the end of the day, you are the one whose time and whose efforts are being utilized. And, you know, if the end product does not meet the requirement, then all the effort goes into waste. So always try to bring everybody on the same page and then move ahead, rather than just, you know, going with one person and saying that the other would manage. Don't do that. Try to avoid that in most of the scenarios. So I think this is it, Piyush.
Yes. So we have some more questions, but we'll take them afterwards on Slack. I'll copy paste this question on Slack and we can take them forward from there. So
cool. Thank you for your time. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks a lot for taking our time and conducting the session.
Sure.
Yeah, so for all those who attended the session, recording of the session will be published on our YouTube channel. I'll share link of the session on the Slack channel as well. So you can also subscribe to our upcoming events, and you can, I'm just sharing link of the YouTube channel and our community in the chat section. So you can join our community and subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay updated with the recordings.
So that's okay, all the best, guys. Thank you for having me.
Thanks a lot.